Hello viewers, welcome to one more edition of MinorCare Positive Life series. A recent World Health Organization report links eyesight to productivity. And in the context of India, eyesight and productivity and loss of productivity has been attributed to billions of dollars. While we are not getting into the nuances and semantics of the report, but the tone is just set. Eyesight today is just not an individual affair. It has taken gigantic proportions for all of us. We've come to meet Dr. Mahipal Singh Sachdev, Chairman and Managing Director of Center for Sight. We'll try to know from him about eye care, how the medical infrastructure as far as eye care is shaping up, medical tourism, and much more. Over to Dr. Sachdev. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time. On the behalf of my viewers, I would really thank you for sparing time from your busy schedule.
My pleasure.
Sir, I was referring to a report by World Health Organization,
mm-hmm.
which links eyesight and productivity.
Mm-hmm.
While we will not get into the semantics of the report, I would really like to know on behalf of our viewers what all we can do and how safe we are at this point in time as far as eye care is concerned. So my first question to you, doctor, is what are the common causes of eye problem in India?
Okay, if you look at eye problems across the globe, the commonest kind of eye problem is the need for glasses. That's called as refractive errors. But that's something which we really do not consider as a major problem. But yes, the incidence of people requiring glasses is going up. But if you look at a disease profile, apart from refractive errors, or if you look at causes for blindness, the leading cause of blindness in India is cataract. So there is a difference between causes for blindness and the causes of what a person comes to us with an eye problem. So then if you look at eye problems, you will have people needing refractive errors, people having dry eyes, people having conjunctivitis. Those are the main problems for which a patient comes to us. But blindness is, in developed countries, the leading cause is diabetic retinopathy and its ill effects. In India, it is unfortunately cataract. Cataract is a curable disease by surgery, but it is the lack of availability of surgical tools across the length and breadth of the country that people still continue to remain blind. Now, refractive error is essentially where the light coming from a distance does not come to a point focus on the retina.
Right.
So what it means is that the power of the entire part of the eye is different from what is that of a normal individual. So you would require some kind of aid, either in the form of glasses or contact lenses, or nowadays people can look at refractive surgery to obviate the need of glasses. Glasses or the need of refractive error could be either myopia, that means that a person cannot see well for distance, and to correct that, a person would require to wear minus power glasses. The second is called as hyperopia, wherein the person would require a plus number glass to be put to see clearly. And the third thing is called as astigmatism. So astigmatism means that a person has to wear cylindrical power. What it means is that the power of an eye in one axis is different from the power in the other axis. So the glass that you are going to wear is going to be having a different power in both the meridian. So what you need to correct that is called as astigmatism, is called as cylindrical power. And then you could have combinations of that. So you could have a myopia with astigmatism, or you could have a hyperopia with astigmatism, or a pure astigmatism. These are the main types of refractive errors. Now the next thing that happens is that as a person ages, that means as a person grows more than 40-45 years of age, the normal lens that a person has within the eye loses its elasticity, or it starts to lose its elasticity. And therefore, a young person who has the power to accommodate, that means that the lens can change its shape so a person can see both near and distance with the same power or without glasses, that goes down.
Right.
And a person needs separate glasses for near and distance, and that is called as presbyopia. So
right.
This is the commonest kind of thing. which really is dealt with by opticians or optometrists. Eye care professionals or surgeons like us basically look at disease profiles and do surgical interventions, etc., etc. But the maximum number, so if you look at any person over 45 years of age, he would require a glass for reading. And if you look at myopia, hypermetropia, etc., the population percentage could be as high as between 30 to 40% requiring glasses.
Okay.
Now, unfortunately, with the use of all these things which a person uses for near work, that means you have your smartphones, you have your computers, you do a lot of reading work, the eye naturally is made for distance vision. But when you are reading or doing these kind of work, you are actually straining the eye. And it has been shown that this is increasing the incidence of myopia.
Right.
So more kids are getting myopic nowadays, and therefore the need for glasses is happening. There was a survey that was carried out maybe about a decade ago by A.C. Nielsen in India, where they went to good schools and they checked the vision of kids. So for every one kid who was wearing a glass, there was another kid who really did not know that he or she needs to wear glasses. So that's the kind of magnitude that we are talking of. So from an average percentage, you can say that about 10-15% of the kids may not even know that they need to wear glasses.
Right.
And unfortunately, there is no medical entrance test for a child when a child goes to school, or also when a kid is born, they don't call an ophthalmologist. So there needs to be a periodic checkup,
right,
for the for children to see that if and when they are needing the glasses to be worn, they are given in time so that the power does not progress.
So from a very holistic point of view, you are hinting at the fact that schools should have programs,
yes,
to take care of the kids in terms of IT.
Yes, and even when a kid is getting admitted, they should be subjected to a medical examination, which should include an eye examination. It's not for screening out people from getting into school, but to find out, it's like a wellness program that you, if you have something is detected early, then that can be treated early and in a more effective manner.
Doctor, thank you for the inputs. I would like to ask you how pollution,
yes,
lifestyle,
yes,
I mean these are self-inflicted to an extent, is,
yes,
affecting our eyesight.
Okay, if you let me just take something which is more affecting the eyesight from a fact that it could be more debilitating to the vision, and that is your lifestyle. By lifestyle, what we have done is the kind of junk food that we eat, the lack of exercise, sedentary lifestyle, etc., etc. So we are becoming the diabetic capital of the world. And diabetes, as I told you, is having an ill effect on the eye. And even in the most developed countries, you can delay that ill effect, but you may not be able to treat it fully.
Right.
So what happens is that because of diabetes, there is some amount of mismatch between the oxygen that is being supplied by the altered blood vessels to the retina and the requirement. So that causes the formation of new blood vessels in the retina, and it causes leakage. And this can lead to sight-threatening complications like vitreous hemorrhage, like bleeds, like new vascularization, etc., etc. So that needs to be treated. So given a long enough life, a diabetic will develop diabetic retinopathy. But if a person has good glycemic control, that means the sugars are within good control, he does not smoke, lipid profile is good, and BP, etc. is controlled, then the chances of the diabetic retinopathy occurring go down. So this is from, then you have the lifestyle. We are always on the high street, so you have hypertension that's increasing. Again, hypertension can have an ill effect on the eye. So these are lifestyle related diseases which happen systemically, which can cause problem on the eye. Overworking will give you strain. One doesn't give rest to the eye, so by the time you have asthenopia or eye headache, etc., by the time you work, say, 1 hour on the computer, 2 hours on the computer, you don't feel well, and that makes you irritable and headache, etc., etc. Apart from that, you raise the question of pollution.
Right.
Now, pollution, as you nowadays, it was a lot in the news, etc., there is something called as particulate matter. There is something called as noxious gases, etc.
Right.
Now, what happens is that all of them, the eye is an exposed portion. There is a lot that is written about kids getting bronchial asthma, etc., because that again is something that you breathe in and that the mucosa gets this thing. So similarly, the conjunctiva of the eye or the mucosa is an exposed part. So when this is getting exposed to these allergens, they would cause an allergic conjunctivitis. That is point number one. And the second thing is that the tear film, that a normal tear that is produced, that becomes labile. That means there is an instability of the tear film and it breaks up.
Right.
So there is a great increase in the incidence of dry eye.
Right.
As it is, when a person ages, the amount of tears that are secreted, especially in women postmenopausal, they tend to go down slightly. But if you get this compounded by pollution, constant irritation, constant instability of the tear film, the lipid profile of the tear film gets altered. So that causes a severe amount of dry eye.
Right.
Now, dry eye is an irritating thing. It may not be blinding. So what it does is that your eyes do not feel fresh. The luster of the eyes goes down. The color of the conjunctiva, you feel that it's lusterless. And then you have irritation, chronically inflamed eyes, red eyes. By the time you go back in the evening, scooter, motorcycle, if you have done and you have had all of those, so you would feel smarting, burning, photophobia, watering, etc. So those are the things that happen. So I think these are the things which environmental pollution are bringing about to our eyes.
Doctor, as far as the infrastructure is concerned,
yes.
I mean, India has obviously moved in leaps and bounds in terms, yes, of infrastructure all across.
Yes.
And medical care is not left behind.
Yes.
But still, we see a lot of gap in the core sector,
yes,
rural and the city.
Yes.
I would like you to comment on the current infrastructure and how they spread out.
See, typically what is happening is that for any eye specialist or an eye hospital to be sustaining itself, you have to do X number of surgeries or you have to see X number of patients to make it viable. When you go to a small place, the number of patients that are available would be less. So the infrastructure, that is the bottleneck, is not that you should have an eye hospital in every village, but the ability of a person to travel some distance to get a specialized eye care should be facilitated. And that's lack of money for people to travel, that's lack of roads, that's lack of vehicles, etc. So that is what is causing. So ultimately, in India, we have about 20,000 ophthalmologists and we should have at least 1 lakh as per the normal this thing. And it's only when you have more ophthalmologists that they will permeate in deeper. Just now, the normal typical approach is that there are societies or organizations which go to villages, set up eye camps, and then they transport the patients to the base hospital to do the surgeries. But obviously, a lot of time they are done as bulk surgeries.
Right.
And sometimes you could have adverse events happening which could
And we hear about that.
Yeah, you hear about that. That's why I raised this point. So ultimately, if a person is able to communicate on a daily basis and not wait for an eye camp to be set up or something like that, that is what the infrastructure requires. Mobile satellite telemedicine would be one way forward. That is that you could have, like, for example, we have this room, this similar kind of equipment could be fitted into a van and one could go and one could screen out patients and then ask the patient that you need this and you please come to the base hospital, get the surgery done, and not as a horde, but on a continuum basis. So that's what I feel, that's the way forward for India. That is what needs to be done. Otherwise, infrastructure is coming in thick and fast. If you look at city hospitals for ophthalmology, we have technology that is best in the world. There is, I would say, no technology that's available, say, in US, which we don't have. Maybe at times we get technology faster than them because the FDA US at times takes much longer for them to get approvals. So cutting edge technology, skill set of doctors doing more number of cases, being more proficient, being able to adapt them to Indian circumstances to keep the cost low, etc. That's all there. But ultimately, the poor people who are in the far-flung areas, it is the inability to kind of travel to places where you have eye care. That is the bottleneck, I would say.
Sir, I will shift you from welfare economics to pure play economics.
Yes.
Where we are going to ask you questions on medical tourism as
yes.
far as eye care is concerned.
Yes.
How is India faring?
I think medical tourism as regards ophthalmology is basis working on two, three things. The first thing is that there are certain surgeries which are out of pocket expense across the world, and that the biggest of that is the laser vision correction. That means that the LASIK surgery that you do for removal of glasses. Now that's an out of pocket expense everywhere. Typically the costs are about 1/5 to 1/6 or 1/10 of what it is costing somebody outside. So we do get a lot of patients from overseas to come in and get this procedure done, because it's essentially a walk-in, walk-out procedure. You just do test on one day and next day you can do the procedure, and the patient is not admitted or the patient doesn't need any hospitalization, etc., etc. So that is one bulk of it that one then. The second thing is that you are looking at procedures or surgeries which are complex in nature, which say an Afghanistan or an Iran or an Iraq or you could even say a Bangladesh or maybe a Nepal, they are not able to provide. So it is for these complex surgeries. For example, you are looking at a vitreoretinal surgery, something in the retina, you are looking at corneal grafts, you are looking at ocular tumors. Our facility gets a lot of patients for ocular tumors to our Hyderabad center. We have actually a tie-up even with the Sultanate of Oman. So those are high-end procedures which they would prefer to come to India because of the cost advantage and the equal outcomes that we have as compared to Western this thing. And then apart from that, there are even some places where there are insurances. For example, if you look at England, the NHS allows them to do cataract, but then there is a waiting line. So patients don't at times want to wait. So those are again patients who do come for medical tourism.
So we have a distinct cost advantage as far as
distinct cost advantage. Yes.
And you mentioned on the fact that we are world standard.
Yes.
So research.
Yes.
And infrastructure and technology go hand in hand.
Yes.
So one is linked to the other. As far as bringing in technology from outside, we are not behind, what I can feel by interacting with you. But what about indigenous research? How are we placed?
I would therefore, what you are saying, that's a dichotomy. It's not necessary that research and technology, somebody else can be doing a research and you could just be importing technology, and that's what India is typically doing. I am one with the Prime Minister to talk about Make in India, but unfortunately when you're looking at high-end technology, there isn't enough R&D that goes into it, or there isn't enough kind of innovation to bring the cost down that is available. So by far, if I have to import a laser, I have to import a high vitrectomy or whatever, top-end equipment. We can have examination equipments like these which are made in India, but they still are not of that standards.
Right.
So the basic problem in research is that when you are talking about research, what India does is re-research. It is not research. What we are doing is clinical application of something that has been discovered elsewhere. Ke bhai, ye dawai is working there. Does it work in Indian circumstances? They need government approval for that medicine to come in, etc. Those kind of things. But research as a fundamental research is hypothesis. Whenever you are looking at research, you have to hypothesize and you have to say that does this is the problem, could this be a solution, and then work on it. More often than not, majority of the researches do not reach the hypothesis. So there is a lot of money that goes down the drain.
Right.
So that is the problem of India, that you do not have enough money to make it go down the drain. That is the only problem, and that is a given. Like you have startups, you have venture capitals coming in, so it's only 1 in 10 or maybe 1 in 50 which are going to be successful, the rest would fail. But then you have to germinate these ideas, and that is where research comes in. I have spent 20 years in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, but if I look back at All India Institute being the premier place, has there been anything which has changed eye care or which has changed healthcare? I would say there are very limited such things. So research needs to be, it needs money to be pumped in, and you need dedicated people to do research. And that again is an economic burden. So I think it's only with the stage of growth and development that one will get research. And that's where India is lacking. But importing technology is really not an issue. That fortunately, the constraints are much less, though there is some duty that is still there. But it comes under OGL, so we can anybody can import the equipment which has been developed elsewhere and put it to use in India.
Doctor, it is sometimes a relief to yes. know that latest technology, latest equipments are there in the country and
yes.
it can help us.
Yes.
So if you can just highlight on the latest technology or equipments which are in India and viewers would feel happy to know about it.
Okay, so let me just look at the two main things that I have talked. Every ophthalmology or eye care today is super specialization. It's not that we are looking at eye as one part. So there are people within us who super specialize in certain things. Now, if you look at, say, let's say cataract surgery. Cataract surgery started in India by somebody called as Shushut. India has given rise, given the first cataract surgery to the world as per literature, whatever it says. But then it evolved over time and it became a no-stitch cataract surgery. Now the latest in cataract surgery is a femtosecond robotic, semi-robotic you can say, cataract surgery, which is called as a blade-free femtolaser cataract surgery. So that is something which is very new, which got approved in the world less than 10 years ago. And today, I think India has about 80 such units. We personally own about 9 of these units and we have across our center. So blade-free cataract surgery increases the precision and accuracy and the outcomes of the cataract surgery, and it is slightly more gentle to the eye. So that is one technology that is available, which is reasonably new. When you look at laser vision correction, the latest technology that's available, which again is less than a decade old, is called as blade-free, flap-free laser vision correction. Earlier, one used to use a blade to make a flap and then reshape the cornea and put back the flap. So this flap, even though it sticks onto the cornea, it did not contribute to the strength of the cornea. And this flap was earlier made with a blade, then there was a femto laser which came. Which could lift up this flap. But now this femto laser is used to make a small lenticule and through a 2 mm incision instead of a full flap, take out the lenticule. So that is called as blade-free, flap-free smile surgery. Smile, the meaning small incision lenticule extraction. Now this is available across the world except in US. US is in the final phases of FDA approval. So we are ahead of US. And again, we have had this technology for the last several years, and that is again a new technology that's available. Macular degeneration for retinal problems, there also there are new types of injections which are coming, so they are also new technology that's available. So I think from a technology perspective, we are in sync with the world.
Doctor, I do not know how many viewers would be able to really remember the abbreviation of SMILE, but the sound in itself is a relief.
Okay, it's to make it more, it's called as relax smile. So the people say you smile and relax. So basically smile means small incision lenticule extraction.
Okay.
So wherever you are looking as in healthcare, the incisions are becoming smaller. Like in, say you have to get a gallbladder removed,
right.
Would you want an open abdominal surgery or would you go through a keyhole laparoscopic surgery?
Right.
So similarly, smile is becoming a keyhole for laser vision correction.
Right. Doctor, wherever there is innovation, wherever there is technology, the
yes.
overall cost burden to the recipient
yes.
has gone down.
Yes.
Has it happened in India?
Oh, sure enough. You know, whenever there is a particular technology, it will mature and then there will be something new that will come and a new technology will come. So obviously, whenever that new technology comes, that's going to be expensive. But if you are looking at this technology, this is, you would say today, a technology without the bells and whistles. A typical example is if you look at an MRI or CT scan, so you say these many Tesla, etc. So you just get finer slices, etc., etc. But if a person is paying more for the going to the higher Tesla thing, you could pick up more lesions. That's fine. But 95% of the work can be done with a lower machine, that means the machine without the bells and the whistles.
Right.
So this lower end machine would obviously be much cheaper than the newer version. So whenever technology comes in, there will be the older versions which will be price effective. Yes. But newer technology is always going to be more expensive. That's going to add something more, but it's not that the older technology doesn't work. So in Indian circumstances, where the price points are not too great, you could be working with slightly older technologies which are delivering.
Right.
If a technology delivered 5 years ago, it's not that it's not going to deliver today, but then there is something better than that. It's like you're going in a car, you had a Maruti, people were very happy, it's fine, but it didn't have, say, a four-wheel drive, or it didn't have auto skid brakes and airbags, etc., etc., but it still brought you to the destination.
Right.
So you do have improvements which are going to add to the cost, but the basic thing which has to, say, take you from one place to the other place, that the Maruti 800 or now it's 1000 or whatever it is, that's going to take you. So similarly, you can have machines without the bells and whistles which can take care of the majority or the larger population of India, and then you have the people who are willing to pay, they could go in for still more advanced technology.
So primarily our viewers or the common man at large should link his pocket to the technology and then do the planning accordingly.
Yes, I would say. So that's basically, you can spend 50 rupees on your lunch, or you could spend 5,000
right.
rupees.
Right.
So you have a basket for, you have the bullock cart still, and you have the aeroplane. So you would have variations in technology and outcomes to some extent, which is going to determine the cost.
Doctor, what would you advise the common masses in terms of daily care that they should do for their eye?
Okay, the first particular thing is that you need to, it won't be daily, but what I am saying is that you need to get an eye examination done once a year. Specific indications for getting an eye examination done are if you have blood pressure, if you have diabetes, if you have a family history of retinal detachment, etc., that is required. Now, from a perspective of daily health of the eyes, etc., it is better to take green leafy vegetables or diet supplements which are rich in vitamin A. Milk is a good source for non-vegetarians. You have cod liver oil, etc., etc. So you can have the vitamin A rich this thing. Apart from that, what you require is that you need to give rest to your eyes, especially when you're working on computers, etc. Palming is a good thing, where you could just after about 20 minutes just palm your eyes for some time. For resurfacing of your tears, if you are working for a lot of time, what we say 20-20 rule, that means after every 20 minutes, rest for 20 seconds and blink your eye 20 times. So that again helps in the resurfacing. When you are going outdoors, it may be a better idea to avoid ultraviolet light, etc. So shades, wearing shades should be good. If you are wearing glasses, the quality of the glasses should be good. They should not be having impurities in them, and that need to be taken care of. Apart from that, convergence exercises at times help, where you could take a pencil or a pen point and bring it nearer to the eye and try to keep that image fused. Moving your eye in all nine directions could be another thing that is there. So these are a couple of tips that a person can do. And for old age people, they should be looking at if you are looking at straight lines, if straight lines become deviated, they become small, squares become smaller or larger, that means that you are having a retinal problem. So you should come and show to an ophthalmologist.
Doctor, thank you for your time. It's really a pleasure talking to you. And on behalf of all our viewers, I really thank you.
My pleasure.